Today, I want to talk to you guys about web design. Man, web design has been one of my biggest revenue streams for my agency since I started back in 2011. And I cannot tell you and stress to you enough of how important it is to build websites the right way. And if you're going to hire somebody to build you a website, there are a number of things. I'm going to go through 10 things today that you need to know when it comes to building a website. So we're going to get into it. So web design is a really, really important part of any business nowadays. In 2020, you cannot not have a website. You have to have a website in 2020, but when you go to build a website, there are some things that you need to look out for and some things that you need to do if you're a web designer and you're watching this that you need to make sure that you implement into your stuff. So I'm gonna go through the 10 things of what you need to include when it comes to building a website. Number one is content. Hey, a lot of people start by building a website and then trying to fill it in with content, and that is the absolute backwards kind of thinking. Now, content is something that I have struggled with for years with clients, sending them emails, asking them to send me their content for their website that they paid for, and waiting weeks, months, and sometimes eternity to ever get anything back from them. And so now when I build websites for people, if they don't have their content ready to go, or they don't have a specific date when they're going to have it ready to go, then they are going to buy a content writing package from me. We will write all the copy for their website, and we're going to have to do a few meetings in order for us to get the content right. So I've created a package that I offer to my clients for the content writing in case they are not able to do it themselves. It's a very, very common issue that web designers run into in this field. And you are going to run into it in yourself if you are actually trying to figure out how to build a website or you hire a company. You need to understand that the content is going to be what the site is built around, not the other way around. Then the second thing is understanding what platform you're going to put your website on. If you're a small little local business like a mom and pop house cleaner or a smog shop, you don't need to go crazy and spend a ton of money on having somebody build you a WordPress website. WordPress is a great platform, but it's not needed for a little mom and pop website. You can use platforms like Weebly or even the GoDaddy website builders. I know there are many of you who are not fans of GoDaddy, but the website builders, the drag and drop builder that GoDaddy has now, I think it's called GoCentral, is a simple, quick way to put up a basic website, especially if you have all your content ready to go. And GoDaddy even does some of that heavy lifting for you and has content that automatically fills in. You can just reword it and make it your own, which makes it a lot easier, okay? So you wanna pick the right platform. Now, if you're an enterprise business or a bigger business like a digital marketing agency or a creative agency or a graphic designer, you need to be able to create a portfolio, have some really nice features on that website that are gonna allow you to expand and grow that website with bigger blog articles and just more customization, especially if you're a designer. You need to be able to have a lot of creativity and show off your flair, and you just can't do some of those things with Weebly. It's really limited in that respect. But if you're going to use WordPress to build a website, you gotta understand that the time commitment between WordPress and a drag and drop builder site is totally different. If you were to take a 5-page website on Weebly and a 5-page website on WordPress, it's gonna take you a minimum of 10 extra hours to 20 hours, 10 to 20 hours additional just to set up the WordPress website correctly. From the hosting of the website, from the plugins that you're gonna need to download, from the security that you're gonna need to implement into your WordPress website, to all the different aspects, configuring those plugins, configuring your theme, customizing things, formatting it for all the different devices. I mean, we're talking about a major difference between the two platforms. And so you need to understand when you're going into it, which platform to pick. Like I said, if you're a small little mom and pop or you're a brand new business and you wanna just get something up and get something online, then Weebly is a great platform to do that. I'm not endorsing them. I'm not paid to endorsing them. I'm only saying that in my experience as a web designer, I've been able to put up a ton of websites for companies and for clients that look absolutely beautiful. In fact, I probably honestly get more compliments on the quick drag and drop Weebly websites than I even do on my WordPress websites. And that says a lot about Weebly. They offer CDN caching. You don't have to worry about setting up the hosting. It's all very, very simple. They have plugins that you can install. Just a lot of really, really good things that you can do with Weebly. And that isn't taking anything away from WordPress, because my adriangraphics.com is a WordPress website. A lot of my client sites are WordPress websites because they need scalability. They have custom applications and custom features and just all kinds of stuff that they want to implement into their website, like pricing tools and calculators and stuff like that. So it's important that you pick the right platform. I can't stress to you that if you spend a bunch of time and money building a WordPress website and you're not ready for it because you're a brand new mom and pop, you're just flushing money down the toilet. And part of my job is to help you save as much money as possible. So that's what I got for you in terms of the platform. Now, when it comes to actual SEO, which is very, very important, if you're new to web design, if you're just starting out as a web designer, or you don't know anything about web design, you're trying to find the right person to hire, you need to understand SEO. And I could probably make an entire video on the breakdown of SEO, and I probably will. It'll be in one of the future videos, but I'm going to do a very brief overview of the elements of SEO that you need to ask your web designer, or you need to, as a web designer, you need to implement into your business and you need to understand. Okay, when it comes to SEO, there are two sides to SEO that are very important. The first side of SEO is your on-page SEO. On-page SEO is the title of your page, the description of your page, the title of your images. I can go on and on and go into depth. All the things that happen on the website, linking from page to page, the favicon, the load speed, all of those things are all important to SEO. The content, again, that's on your website. The longer your content, the better your SEO is going to be. And especially if you're linking keywords and you have links pointing back and you have links you're going out to other people, all of the on-page SEO is really, really important to do that right and to set it up correctly from the beginning. Because it's a pain in the butt to have to go back through all of your content and do it later when you could have just done it right from the beginning. So make sure that you have a good understanding of on-page SEO. And you can look up tutorials, videos on just on-page SEO. You can look up trainings. There's a lot of stuff out there that you can find that's good stuff. Just be careful that you're getting it from a reputable source like Neil Patel, something like that, or even my videos. I talk a lot about SEO in some of my videos. And then you have off-page SEO. Now that is everything for your website that happens off of the website, like Google directories, like Yahoo directories, like directory listings on other sites, mentions, your social media signals, you know, adding your business to Facebook and Instagram and LinkedIn, and creating company profiles. There are ways to sign up with systems and to implement systems into that for your off-page SEO that you can use for your clients or for yourself. Companies like SignUp. And if you haven't heard of SignUp, it's S-Y-N-U-P, and I am actually an affiliate of theirs and a partner, but I'm not a paid endorser. They're not paying me anything. I actually use their service and I have about 80 accounts with them right now for my different clients that we use. But you can add your business to that and it distributes your business out to all of these different platforms. And actually it helps you do voice, helps you get reviews. I mean, there's just tons of great things that are off-page SEO that tell Google that you're a reputable business. So your Google My Business profile is considered off-page SEO. Getting reviews on social media, getting reviews on Google, getting links from other reputable websites, those are all elements of off-page SEO. You have to focus on making sure that you're putting a concerted effort towards the SEO of your website, because that is what's going to funnel traffic with the keywords back to your website. Now, something aside from all the technical and kind of that jargon, because a lot of that can go over people's head and they're not very familiar with it, and it makes them feel very uncomfortable when I talk about that, because some of the terminology. But if you're not familiar with SEO, go look up a cheat sheet and type SEO checklist, and there's a ton of information on SEO checklists that you can find out there. A Diggity Marketing is another one. He does a lot of SEO stuff. He's one of the leading authorities in SEO. And there's also a guy named Mike Woodworth, I believe is his name. Mike or Matthew Woodworth. And you can look his YouTube videos up as well. He's another great SEO authority and can give you a lot of information as well. But the other thing, and this is something that I love personally in every website that I used to spend too much time on, is the creativity. Now, your brand and your website should reflect your brand. You need to make sure that the tone of voice, the look and the feel, the colors, and everything about your brand is reflected on that website. SEO is important, but the creativity and the uniqueness is what's going to help people grab their attention and keep them on the website. And then if the information and the content that's on that website is relevant to what they're looking for, and the site is creative and artistic and unique and beautiful, you're actually gonna hold their attention. So that could be videos, it could be custom graphics. All of these things are important elements that you wanna ask your web designer, or if you are a web designer, you wanna make sure that you include, is having creative elements into the website. there's a lot of this kind of common trend in web design of doing the minimalist approach. And I think there is a time and a place for that for certain businesses. But I think it's important to personalize your website and to make it fit you, your personality, your values, and what makes you special and unique. If you like race cars, make it race car themed, things like that. Just some examples. But it's important that you have creativity and uniqueness to your website. And that's what creativity does, is it makes it unique and it makes it personalized to you and it makes it stand out from the rest of everybody else. Okay, then the other thing that you need to focus on, and you need to ask your web designer, or if you are a web designer, you need to implement, and this is incredibly important because I see a lot of people lose their visitors and they have really high bounce rates, is the user experience. Please listen to me. Do not throw 10, 12, 15, 20, anything over 5 navigation menu items at the top of your website. If you do more than 5, you're giving too many choices, too many options, and it's what's called the paradox of choice. You're giving too many people options and they're not going to make a choice. They'll just leave and go to a website that actually takes them on a journey, that takes them through an experience. So your website should take somebody through an experience, just like if you were to go to a restaurant. If you walk into a restaurant, you're going to stand at the front, you're going to wait to be seated, they're going to take your name and information, then they're going to call your name, they're going to walk you to a table in a specific area based on if you have a kid and all of the needs that they see that you have based on that first judgment, and then they're going to implement putting you at the table with the right server, and they have an entire process and a flow to that restaurant. They get your drinks first, and they have a process, and so your website needs to do the same thing for your customers. It needs to take them through a journey and walk them through an experience of going from point A to point Z, or point 1 to point 10, or whatever that looks like for you. However many steps are in your process, you need to take them through that gradually, and the experience needs to be fun, it needs to be exciting, it needs to be entertaining. These are all important elements to having a successful website and to doing it the right way. Now you're probably asking yourself, what about turnaround times? Well, if you're a web designer, I want you to give your clients realistic turnaround times for developing a website. Now, if your customer, and this is gonna happen like one time out of 100, if you have a customer that already has all their content done, everything's ready to go, all their images are done, their images are titled and categorized, and man, they got it all together, or they have an existing website that's pretty decent, and you're just revamping it, then you should be able to give a 30-day turnaround time. That is a realistic turnaround time, and that's what a customer should expect for just a revamp or something simple that has all of their stuff together. Because building a website is about 20 to 80 hours worth of work, depending on how many pages they have. I'll give this as an example so you have some context. If you have a 20-page website, 30 days is an adequate amount of time to build a 20-page website with all of your stuff ready to go. Now, if you got more than that, you should give a little bit more time. I would say for every 20 pages, you want to give about 30 days. So if you have 30 pages, maybe do it 45 days. So give yourself some breathing room, because things come up, things change. You may send them a mock-up, or you may get a mock-up that you don't really care for, and you're going to have to consider the back and forth changes and revisions that happen, just the delays that are part of that as well. So you want to take that into consideration when it comes to the turnaround time, is giving people realistic turnaround times. Now, if you add something custom to a website, like a custom app or a calculator or a dashboard or a membership site or e-commerce, you need to be able to add an appropriate amount of time for each of those things as well. Because an e-commerce site takes way more time to add in product descriptions and weights and shipping and all these minute details that you don't even realize, product images and optimizing the product images and image titles and image descriptions. I mean, there's just so much that goes into e-commerce sites. So you should be expecting for full-blown build out of an e-commerce site the right way on WordPress. If it's done on WordPress, you're gonna be looking at a 6-month project. That's if they have anywhere between 25 and 100 products. You should be looking at about 6 months. You could probably get it done in 3 or 4 months if you have everything together, but you want to give yourself enough breathing room to do the site the right way, because the worst thing you could do is build a site for somebody for whatever amount of money, and then it doesn't perform. It doesn't get traffic. It doesn't get traction. If you build it, they will not come. You have to build it the right way, and you have to be able to understand how the traffic works and how you're going to get traffic to the website. And that is part of this video as well, is you need to ask the customer, what kind of customer base do they already have? What kind of traffic do they already have? And understand and get an assessment of that. So whoever is doing your website, or if you're doing a website, you need to do an assessment upfront of the situation, figure out how much traffic do they currently have coming to the website? What are the opportunities? What are the threats? What are the strengths? And what are the weaknesses? Those are all, they call it a SWOT analysis: strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. And you need to have somebody that's gonna take you through that process. Many web designers are skipping all of that stuff, just making something that looks pretty and putting it up on the web, and then it never performs. And regardless whether you spend $500 or $5,000, if you build a website like that, it's gonna cost you money in the long term. The opportunity cost is huge. So you wanna make sure that you don't skip those steps, that you do every step from A to Z of the alphabet when it comes to the website, that you're not skipping, you know, your SEO, your off page, your on page. That is very important. And then the next thing that I'm gonna lead to here is something that many web designers are not doing. And this is something that I'm implementing now into all of my websites starting just about a week ago, is ADA compliance. There are companies like Target and online commerce companies that are not ADA compliant. People, 76% of people, according to, I think it's HubSpot, have reported that they shop online. 76% of people, this is US, in the US, are shopping online. Think about how many consumers that is. That's like probably 200 million shoppers that are shopping online. How many of those people do you think have disabilities? Whether it's reading disabilities, hearing disabilities, sight, whatever their disability is, you need to make sure that your website is supportive of those people. Just like ADA compliance for retail businesses, when you're walking into a restaurant, you need to be able to have wheelchair access, right? It's the same thing for a website. You need to have an ADA compliant website. If you really want to take it a notch above, you can also implement language changes. So you can implement like Google and Google Translate, where the whole website translates into Spanish or translates into a foreign language. I don't really consider that ADA compliance. The stuff that I consider is more like making sure you have your alt tags, making sure that someone that is hearing impaired can actually listen to certain things, and you have subtitles and captions on videos. All those things, we're taking all those into consideration when we build websites for clients, because we want to make sure that we can reach all of your customers and that we're not segmenting out a specific portion of group of people that are hearing impaired or visually impaired. We want to support all those people. So ask that question as well, is what are you doing for ADA compliance on websites? And you'll be surprised, probably out of 1,000 companies you talk to, 999 of them are not focused on that whatsoever, okay? And then depending on the platform you pick, if you go with Weebly, the beautiful part about it is not only is it pretty affordable, it's a little bit more expensive than WordPress for the monthly hosting, but you don't have to worry about any of the ongoing maintenance of the website. You're not having to update plugins really. It happens every once in a while, but the site is very, very secure versus WordPress. When you download WordPress plugins like a Revolution slider or things like that, you have to update those plugins. And then on top of that, you have to update WordPress itself. The actual platform that you've built the website on has to be updated. And what happens is when you update WordPress, you have a specific theme that you've paid for, a theme that you've had developed. Now you have to update that theme, and then you have to also update the plugins to be matching up with the latest version of WordPress. So there's a maintenance fee that goes along with that. So typically, in the long run, the actual monthly cost to maintain a WordPress website is much more expensive than a Weebly website. That is a really important thing to factor in when it comes to choosing whether you're gonna build one or not. You need to understand that there's a monthly maintenance cost of building a WordPress website, and or even like a Joomla. There's other platforms out there, but I mainly am gonna focus on WordPress and Weebly today because those are my go-to platforms that I trust and rely on that I know have proven results for me. So aside from that, you wanna make sure that you're doing ADA compliance, and then QA. QA is a huge one, quality assurance. You wanna make sure that that website actually works on Internet Explorer. Don't get me started on Internet Explorer. It's like the bane of my existence. Chrome, Firefox, DuckDuckGo, there's tons of browsers out there now. Microsoft Edge, you wanna make sure that your website looks great in all of those browsers, right? Okay, that's what I'm talking about. Web design is much more complicated and it goes a lot deeper than you probably have ever even thought of or realized. Most people think, oh, I just get a Squarespace website and put up a quick website and in 4 hours my website's done. It doesn't work like that. I don't care who you are, how simple your business is. If you spend 4 hours on your website, you're getting garbage and it's an absolute waste of your time. You need to build a website that's gonna generate you traffic, that's gonna rank, that's gonna bring you leads and bring you business, right? That's what you're investing into a website for in the beginning. And a lot of people think of websites as an expense. And part of this video, what I want you to be able to take away from this is if you do it the right way, a website is not an expense. Yes, it is a business write-off, but it's an investment. And investments have a return on an investment. When you make an investment in something, you're expecting to make your money back in return. And if you do it the right way and you have a website that not only complies with all of the browsers, with ADA compliance, with the search engine optimization rules and guidelines, and also is user experience friendly and all of these different things you incorporate into it, but then you gotta think about, what device are they on, right? This is a whole nother area and realm that I could go on and on about, and I don't want to make this video too long, but you need to make sure that your website looks great on tablets and it looks good on mobile. Those are the two most important parts of a website nowadays that you have to have. You have to have a website that's mobile friendly. And I coined a term a few years ago before this became a huge thing, and my term was mobile first. Not mobile friendly, but mobile first. When you build a website, you should be thinking about the website from a design perspective and a user experience perspective from a mobile device, because 60 to 70% of people are starting their searches on a mobile device, right from their Google, leads them to a landing page on their cell phone or their tablet. And then you make sure that all the desktop stuff looks great. It's important to have a desktop version as well, because there is a big chunk of people that are on desktop still. But the websites need to be mobile first friendly, mobile friendly totally, and need to make sure that they actually look good, the user experience is good, because that's what's going to help you really rank and build your traffic, is having that level of mobile first design and creativity through your site. So those are all the 10 points, and I'll go through them real quick again. You have your platform, you have your content, you have your user experience, you have your creativity, you have your SEO on page and off page, you have your turnaround times that you need to understand, what's gonna be the monthly maintenance of it, the quality assurance of making sure there's no bugs or broken links or things like that on the site, because that happens often, and then the ADA compliance and making sure that all people can read your website, visit your website, and interact with your website the right way. And then the last one, and actually I probably should have put this up in higher priority because I did it from first to last, but is the mobile first and mobile friendliness. You need to make sure that your site is mobile friendly, that it looks stunning on mobile first, and then worry about the desktop stuff. If you can get your site to look great on mobile and tablet, then when it comes to the desktop stuff, it'll be easy. So that is, in a nutshell, the 10 things that you need to worry about and you need to look for and you need to focus on for your clients. If you're a web designer or graphic designer and you're upselling web design, or you're hiring a web designer, anything to do with building a website and creating a website for yourself or for your clients, this is a guideline and standards that you should be following and thinking about. And one last thing, I want to give you a little gold nugget here, is website speed. You need to make sure that you have an agreement with your web designer or with your client that you're gonna make sure that their website loads in a specific amount of time, because this can cost a significant amount of traffic. Okay, if your website loads, it takes longer than 3 seconds, you're gonna lose 70% of your visitors. That means if you send 1,000 visitors, 700 of them are gonna leave right away if your site wait takes more than 3 seconds to load. That is a devastating number, right? Can you imagine spending all that time, money, effort, and energy to get 1,000 visitors to your website, and because it loads so slow, 700 of them leave? Okay, I always shoot for my team to have 1 second load times and at the most 2 seconds. And most of our sites do load within that. And even with some video on our sites, we still load within 2 to 3 seconds, and 3 seconds is our threshold. If it's more than that, then we have something wrong and we have to go in there and fix it, minifying CSS. And there's just all kinds of technical stuff I could talk to you about, but make sure that your website loads quickly, because that is an increasingly important aspect of web design. Is someone sitting there for 5 seconds just waiting for the page to load, they're like, oh man, I'll just go somewhere where I can find the information and get what I want. People's attention spans are shorter than ever. So make sure you do that. Make sure you follow those guidelines. I want to see you have the greatest website. If you implement these into your website, I promise you, you'll see a significant change in your traffic, in your growth, and make sure you find the right person. Oh, one last thing, pricing. What should you pay for a website, or what should you charge for a website? Now, those are two totally different questions, and they vary depending on the web designer and the type of website and the platform. In general, as a general rule, if you are going to hire a web designer and they tell you it's going to take you a month, okay, they're probably predicting it's going to take 20 to 40 hours, I'm guessing. It's going to be a week solid worth of work, half a week or a week solid worth of work. You should be willing to invest or pay or charge about $2,500. That's a fair rate to have a website done the right way, even on Weebly, 20 to 40 hours worth of work. Now, like I told you, when you go to WordPress, it becomes more expensive, right? It takes more time, and that time is money. And it's worth more than money, to be honest with you. So if you're going to build a WordPress website, you should be expecting a price of no less than $5,000. Whether you're paying somebody or you're charging somebody that price, you should charge a minimum of $5,000. If you are charging less than either one of those prices that I said, not only are you hurting yourself and costing yourself money, even if you're the one, if you're the customer, and I know you're trying to save as much money as possible, keep it in your pocket, but it's good, the opportunity cost and what you're going to lose by not doing it the right way is going to way outweigh it. But if you're charging less than that, then you're cutting corners, and you do not want to cut corners when it comes to building a website. This is something that you need to invest a significant amount of time into. It's super important to do this. So do the website the right way. $2,500 to $5,000 is basic 10-page website. Once you go up there, up from there, the prices should increase. If you got a 20-page website, you should be closer to $10,000 on WordPress. If you got a 50-page website, you should be closer to like $20,000. You just do the math. As more pages, it takes more time. You got to implement more stuff, more SEO, all these different things, compliance and QA and all those things. So just keep that in mind. That should be a baseline. I'm here to try to help the industry, the graphic design, the web design, the creative industry, the marketing industry. That is my mission, is to help the industry and also help the end user and the customer, the business owner, the entrepreneur. That is who I love and I care about and I want to help. So I hope this all helps you. I know it was a longer winded video than I normally do, but there's just a ton of information when it comes to this that people fall short on, that people cut corners on, and I'm tired of seeing it. It gives the industry a bad name. It hurts the businesses. It hurts small business. And I have a passion for small business. I want to help you win. I want to help you succeed. So if you love this video, make sure you hit the subscribe button. Please, I beg you, I'm literally begging you, please hit the subscribe button. I know that's desperate, but it's because I need to be able to create content and I need to be able to reach more people. And the more subscribers I get, the more YouTube sees that and the more I'm able to impact my community, my industry, and small business owners around the country and hopefully around the world. So I hope you enjoyed this video. Thank you so much for spending the time with me today. I love you guys. And as always, keep looking up.